What's going on, guys? Welcome to the Against All Odds podcast. I'm here with, okay, first of all, I got to figure out your name because I feel like your name switches every single time. McKinney, Moses, but then what's Gabinda?
Benga?
Benga, yeah.
That's my middle name. That's what everybody calls. My friends call me that. So
just Benga?
Yeah, so you can not call me that.
Just kidding. So, okay. What's your full name then?
Moses Benga McKinney.
Got it. Moses Benga McKinney. Yeah. All right, and then you're a left back.
I am.
And I you're 26 years old. 26 years old.
26.
All right, all set. All right, let's roll the intro, and then we'll get into Moses' story. All right, so Moses, you've been playing for a while. You've been playing pro for a number of years, right?
Yeah.
Let's go back to like when you first started playing soccer, all the way back, and like where you were born, and just let's just go from there. And just full story.
So I started as early as I could remember. My dad played, my brother played, so my whole family pretty much played. So I just grew up playing. Mm-hmm. I was born in England, so in England everyone plays.
Yeah.
I mean, play rugby, cricket, but everyone plays. You go in the park, you play. So I think I started actually like real competitive soccer around the age of 9. That was when I moved to the States. Mm-hmm. In England, I'd played like with some small academies. And actually, interesting thing is before I left, I was invited to go train with Charlton's under, I think it was 9 team. So that would have been, who knows, maybe I would have been on Charlton. But yeah, so from there, I moved to the States and started off in Baltimore, played for Baltimore Bays. Mm-hmm. They no longer exist. But we're a really good team. And then, yeah, so from there, college, pro.
Yeah, all right. But why did you move from England over to America?
So my dad had a job opportunity here in the States. Uh-huh. And he just thought it was a good idea to move the family. So we all moved. And yeah, it's been the best thing for me, I think.
Is your dad originally from England?
So he was born in England, but he is Nigerian.
Uh-huh.
So my mother's Nigerian, so my whole family's Nigerian. So we're first, I guess technically we're second generation British since he was born in England, but really and truly we're first generation because he didn't grow up in England.
Uh-huh. Does he have an accent, like an English accent? Or
he does not.
No?
He does not.
That's funny.
He does not.
Yeah, did you have an English accent when
I did.
Yeah. All right, that's funny. And then so you moved over here to Baltimore when you were 9, you said, right?
Yeah, I moved when I was 9.
All right. And then how was your youth, like, playing? Was it just successful? Like,
yeah, actually, it was really successful.
From 9 all the way up until, like, 18?
From
9 all the way up.
And I have plaques from when I was 9 years old. From 9, we were really good, but we didn't have, like, rankings and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I think it started off at 10 or something like that. But we were the number one team in the country from, like, at that age.
Really?
Yeah, it was just crazy. Like, I fell into, like, the perfect setup.
Uh-huh.
The team was, like, 5 minutes from my house. And so we were just a really good team. And as we got older, the better players kind of came to the area. Not came into the area, but they came and played with our team that mm-hmm. were around the area. So as we got older, we just got better and better, got stronger players. And so,
yeah. How long were you with that team for? Like all the way up until 18?
All the way.
No,
all the way. Yeah. So
Baltimore Bays from 9 to 18.
So what happened was we changed, we would like switch. So we were the Baltimore Bays at first, and then we switched to Potomac, with Potomac Fusion for a while. I think it was maybe two years, mm-hmm. and then we went back to the Bays. So we were originally with a coach named Anthony Carver, best coach I've had.
Yeah.
Taught me everything I know.
Wow. You're going to just diss Mike like that?
I mean, best coach I've had through the ranks. Shout out Mike Ensign. No, but he was a really good coach. He taught us all the fundamentals. And then from there, we switched. We left him, but the whole team moved. So it wasn't necessarily the same team, but it was same team name, but it was the same team. So all the players, we moved to Steve Nichols, who's actually coaching at Loyola University.
Really?
And we were Baltimore Bays. And he had success with a lot of older, like the older clubs.
Mm-hmm.
So he had U, when we were under 14, he had a U19 and a U17 team.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like really, really good national champions and stuff like that. So,
damn. Yeah. Damn, that's crazy. how many of the guys like from your U9 team are like those, that basic core group of players are playing pro?
From that U9 team?
Yeah, or like
I'm
just
only,
that.
From that team, I'm the only one left.
Playing
pro? But three of us made it. Uh-huh. But from the years that I've played, I would say they're still currently playing. Wow. It's only three of us.
Damn.
It's only three of us.
That's pretty crazy. That's good though. Yeah, I mean, from a youth team like that, like to have three players still playing.
Yeah. But we had at one point maybe like five. Yeah, maybe like five or six.
Uh-huh.
And then, because, you know, as you get older, like, for example, like U18, we had a couple guys join at U18, the academy level.
Mm-hmm.
And they were really good players, but they weren't with that core group. And they ended up going professional. So they also count in that in that number.
Damn, that's sick. So were you always, you weren't always a left back?
No, I wasn't.
What position were you playing from 9 until 18?
So when I was 9, I was a central midfielder. I was a central midfielder. I was the best central midfielder.
In the nation.
No, I'm just kidding. I was a central midfielder. I was really small. I was always small. I didn't grow until my sophomore year of high school. I went into high school 5'4", 94 pounds.
That's like the same exact thing for me.
I was tiny.
Yeah, I was tiny too. I was like around there. I was like, I think... 5 foot, yeah, around 5'3", 5'4", but I was like 100 pounds.
Yeah,
like I broke 100 right before I went into high school.
Yeah, I
was stoked about that.
I didn't at all.
But you're like 6'1" now, right?
Yeah, 6'1".
And like 180, 190?
Yeah, 185, 180. Yeah, depends on the day.
It depends on the double day.
Yeah.
So you're a super late bloomer, but you were a central midfielder the whole time?
No, not the whole time. So then I moved to left mid. I think it was about 14. Mm-hmm. I moved out to the wing, left mid, and then I had it's like one of my best friends. I've known him since I was 9. He is the reason why I'm a left back now. He was late to a game in high school, and the coach decided to play me at left back because the left back went to center back, and then I ended up playing left back.
Uh-huh.
Had a really good game. And then from then on, I've just been a left back.
Really?
Been a left back.
So you owe your position now with like the Tulsa Roughnecks because your friend was late to a game.
Marquez Fernandez.
That's pretty crazy.
Yeah.
The natural positioning and defending like came pretty easy to you? Like the positioning? Did you ever feel like you were completely lost switching from center mid to left mid or left mid to left back?
I honestly felt more lost switching from center mid to left mid. But when I was playing center mid, I was more so defensive. I was a deeper playmaker.
Mm-hmm.
So it was natural to kind of be in a defensive shape and stuff like that. Yeah. So when I went to left back, the one thing that I realized, I had a lot of time on the ball.
Yeah.
So it was like all this green space, green grass, and I would just, you know, go dribble, whatever.
Yeah.
I had to learn how to kind of play the game the right way at that position.
And but not just fly up the field every single time.
Yeah. Exactly.
Yeah. No, that was something I noticed too from like striker, of being like everybody is like on your back, or like you always have to like every, like you're in the center of the field, to literally just having no worry about anywhere like right of you or behind you. It was like, it's good and bad because you can take advantage of it to the point of like you need to stop dribbling so much.
Yeah.
But yeah. All right, so you were, so 18 then. So you were, actually, let's go to sophomore year. So sophomore year, you were starting to go through your growth spurt.
Yeah.
Growth spurt.
Yeah.
How did that, like, help? Or?
It helped a lot. But at the same time, it was a very big challenge. So I go from being someone who never wins headers to now being expected to win headers.
Yeah.
So before, like, I would never really... I didn't really challenge headers. I would just jump into somebody and hope he, like, didn't head the ball.
Yeah.
To now I'm tall enough to actually win the header. I'm expected to win the header.
Mm-hmm.
I was still really skinny. I'm not huge now, but I was...
You're tiny, yeah.
But I was like, I was really, really skinny. So I was trying to add weight and, you know, when you grow so fast, start having knee problems, stuff like that. So
did you have that Oscar shot?
I didn't. I was lucky enough not to, but I think it's the Oscar Slaughters.
Mm.
I think
yeah.
But
that's not a word guy.
Thanks, baby.
So so I was really, really, really struggling the first maybe 6 to 8 months. And then like when junior year rolled around, I kind of filled out a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was great. When I left high school, I'd gained maybe like, it was like something crazy. It was like 70 pounds and like 6 inches.
Damn.
So I went into high school looking completely different from how I left.
Yeah. That's crazy. Especially too, because like as a left back or outside back, like usually, like I even feel like I'm a tall outside back. I'm like right at 6 feet.
Yeah.
And so like, yeah, like because most outside backs are probably like 5'8".
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
But that's funny. So at 16, sophomore, junior year, were you like highly recruited for college? Was your team still like top in the nation for your club?
Yeah, we were. Wow.
So you must have been like having some looks for colleges.
I had some good looks. Not as much as some of my teammates. Some of my teammates had, I mean, every big school you could think of was on to them. But I had a lot of good looks. But I actually committed late.
Mm.
I committed late. I was waiting it out. I really, really wanted to go to Wake Forest. They did recruit me, and they stopped responding to my emails once I sent my test scores. So I think that was the issue. Also, like, being from Maryland, you always want to go to Maryland. There's a little chatter there. And I just really wanted to stay in the ACC at the end of it. So
ACC is a sick conference, though.
Yeah. So I went to took a visit to NC State, and I loved it there.
Mm.
I loved it. So I just decided to stay with NC State.
Then why did you choose, like, I mean, did you visit a lot of schools? Like, did you go, like, official visits?
Yeah, how many visits did I take? I didn't think I took too many. I think I took maybe 3.
That's pretty good. Yeah.
I took 3. I did a lot of unofficials because I, like junior year, like early junior year, when you could first kind of.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know what the rules are now. I have no idea.
I'm
back then, I think it was junior year, they could start contacting you, mm-hmm. but you couldn't take an official visit. I don't know. I don't know what it was. So I took a lot of unofficial visits. And then when we would do, we'd have like the tournaments and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So when we come down to North Carolina, I'd visit some of the schools. So I'd seen a couple of schools when I came down. But I think when it came time to actually taking official visits, a lot of schools had already been crossed off the list.
Yeah.
And so I think I went to George Mason. I remember I went to George Mason. I took a visit to Maryland, but it wasn't an official visit because it was like 3 of us had went at the same time. We watched them play UNC, which is actually really sick.
Yeah,
it was a sick game. They won. And then I went to another school. I completely forget. Sorry. So I took my visit to NC State like 2 weeks before you had to sign the letter of intent.
Uh-huh.
And
why did you wait?
Honestly,
because were teams saying like, yeah, we want you to verbally commit?
Yeah.
And you just didn't?
And I just didn't. I just kept waiting. And I was just like, I was unsure. And the thing was, I really, really wanted to play in the ACC.
Yeah.
And so I guess some of the offers I was getting, I didn't like so much. And then some of the other schools. So, and then I also lost some offers because of waiting. So then at that one point, you're like, oh, I wish I could go back. And you're like, well, I already missed, I missed the boat on that one. So, so I took the visit to NC State, and they gave me the best offer I could ask for, and I took it.
Uh-huh. That's sick. And so this was senior year?
Yeah, senior year. I committed literally like 2 weeks before. I went on my visit, I came back, and then like a week later, we had signing day.
Damn. That's crazy. That's all right. And then because I was super late too. Like I didn't like if signing day happened, and then I was 2 weeks after that. I wasn't like a top recruit like coming out. Like my team I was like B team in my team. Until I was like 16. But I had like the opposite youth. But that's interesting. All right, and then so How was the summer going into NC State? Like, how were you nervous? Were you just ready? Did you know anybody there already?
Yeah, so crazy thing was, so my cousin had played. He played there the 2 years before.
That's sick.
So, like, and he was a left back. So he left.
Really?
I came in to his position, which it just worked out perfectly. And the crazy part was they didn't know we were related until they saw me at Disney. And they were like, he's really good. Who is he? And my cousin was like, yeah, that's my cousin. They're like, really? You think we can get him? And then it kind of just, that definitely helped, you know, that relationship. But it was great.
That's cool that they started recruiting you before that they even knew.
Yeah, so it made me actually value them.
Yeah, yeah. Because there's nothing worse when it's like, all right, are they just doing this as like a pity thing because they like my cousin and I'm going to be brought in here? And
exactly.
They don't like, yeah. Exactly. That's cool though. How was your time at NC State?
It was great. It was great.
Were you there all 4 years?
All 4 years. I graduated a year and a half early.
A year and a half early?
I mean, sorry.
A half year. I was like,
half a year early. I mean, I probably could have done it in a year and a half, but I was just trying to space it out, you know?
Mm-mm.
So just a half a year early so I could go and play in January. You know, like how it is.
Yeah.
Like the season ends and you want to go play in January. So they really helped me out because I wasn't the best student. A lot of study hall, a lot of tutoring, a lot of, you know.
Yeah.
So they really helped me out get that done. I was there every summer, summer sessions.
Yeah. That's intense.
But it was good, though, because I also played for the NCSC, now North Carolina FC.
Mm-hmm.
I played for their 23s every summer.
Was that PDL?
Yeah, so we weren't PDL. They're PDL now, but we weren't PDL at the time. So I played for their under 23s. And which was, I mean, it was really good. So it was a good setup. I got to play. I was right there, which was like, and it was like 5 minutes from campus. So it was, it worked out well for me.
That's sick. So let's go with your grades too, because you've told me that you're not the best student. Or like you said, you didn't.
Yeah.
So like in high school, like what, you said your junior year, you had like a 2.5. Is that it?
Yeah. I was not the best student. Like I told you before, I went to a private high school.
Yeah.
And I guess the workload for me was a lot different.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, like, I stayed on campus. I was in the dorms. Definitely wasn't doing what I was supposed to be doing, which made life a lot harder.
Yeah.
I'd procrastinate. I'd wait super late to write my papers and stuff like that. And just wasn't really the best student. I guess for me, I always knew soccer was going to be my way out kind of thing. And I leaned on it way too much.
Because you didn't know like what would happen.
Yeah. I leaned on it way too much. I just, you know, the back of my, me and my friend, we always had a saying like, I mean, we'll be fine. We'll get it done. We'll be fine. And I think so. I don't know who it was. They came and told us like to be eligible, you had to have like a 2.2 or something. I don't know.
For high school to be eligible?
To be able to like play
collegiate. Oh, college. Yeah.
Yeah, like, and I was, and when I think once I heard that, it just really just completely messed me up. I just wasn't the best student.
And that, you said it hurt you though, talking to coaches.
Yeah, it hurt me because that definitely hurt my grades.
Mm-hmm.
And then my senior year, I took a lot of easier classes, mm-hmm. get my GPA up. But at that point, it was also too late because when they're recruiting you, your grades have to be what they are. And then they wanted me to get a higher SAT score and stuff like that. And, which I couldn't tell you what I did right now, but I actually did fairly well on the SAT, but I had to do a lot better just because of my grades.
Yeah.
You know, it's one of those
types
of
situations. To make up for the...
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Because what did you graduate high school with?
I believe it was a 3.1 or a 3.0.
Because that's decent, yeah. But like still, like even for like top schools, they're going to be like,
To be fair, like my senior year, because... So you take a lot of like your required, like your, you have to take your required courses. Mm-hmm. So that I didn't take a science my senior year. I took a lot of like elective courses.
Yeah.
And elective courses are a lot easier than biology,
yeah.
calculus, those type of things. So it was, the work was, it wasn't, I wouldn't say easy work, but it was work that you kind of wanted to do.
Yeah.
One of the classes was the history of Baltimore. So for me, like if you're in Baltimore, like you'd rather, you know, go out to the city and look stuff up rather than sitting in the classroom.
Writing about mitochondria.
Exactly.
Of the cell.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. So,
how many guys from your high school team went out? Did a lot of from your high school team go play college?
Yeah. So
any to NC State?
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Damn, that's sick. You have a good setup going all the way up.
Yeah. If my professional career went like my youth career, I'd probably be a multimillionaire.
Yeah. I'm excited to hop in the professional story too.
But so my best friend, so he had committed to, his story was kind of crazy. He committed to Virginia Tech, decommitted, committed to Maryland, decommitted, and then committed to NC State.
Damn, you're just making enemies with all the coaches.
And he had to play both of those schools.
Damn.
You know? So he went with me to NC State same year.
Mm-hmm.
But our high school was like a really good high school. So in Baltimore, high school soccer was really, I guess the private high school soccer was the better league.
Uh-huh.
So a lot of club players played at those schools. So our team, for example, our club coach coached, and he had the older age group and the younger age group, like younger than us.
Mm-hmm.
So what ended up happening was good players from his older group, our group, and the younger group would be on the same team.
Yeah.
So we ended up having like a really, really, really good team. I think 1 year, actually 2 years in a row, we were ranked number one in the country for high school soccer.
Uh-huh.
And then our senior year, we were for like, maybe it was like 2 or 3 weeks, mm-hmm. and then we lost the game and it
killed you guys.
It killed us.
Yeah.
We had a lot of guys, went to UVA, Maryland, Penn, NC State.
That's crazy.
Where else? Some good schools like Cornell, Brown. It was really good.
I was the only person from my high school to go play D1 soccer.
Really?
Yeah. And there's only, I think, two or three others that went, but they were like NAIA or I think one went to D2. But that's
completely
like
completely different experience. Yeah. I think from our start in 11, we had everyone but one, maybe. Yeah.
Dang.
Everyone but one.
Did you do any like extra training when you were like growing up, or was it?
Yeah. Yeah. So that was kind of the thing too that led to me being a bad student was I just decided soccer was what was gonna be what I was gonna do.
Yeah.
So
at what age?
When you're young, you're like, yeah, I'm gonna play soccer. I'm playing professional soccer. So that was always the mindset. But in high school, like, so I'd say 14.
Yeah.
I was like, yeah, I'm gonna play soccer. So I'm gonna do whatever I could. And he was a senior. I was a junior at the time. He's a good friend of mine. He'd come out with us. He'd help us like train, and he was a really, really good player. He was like Gatorade National Player of the Year, like that type of.
Wow.
He was a big deal, and he would help us. We'd go out with him, like play, like after school, sometimes in between, like during free periods, stuff like that. And for me, I just chose. You know what? Like I'm not gonna read these chapters tonight. I train today. I'm gonna play FIFA in the dorms, like stuff like that. Yeah. Instead of like actually, you know, I considered the extra work, which was pretty stupid. I don't know why.
But it worked out. But like it, yeah, I know what you mean.
Yeah.
Like, it's hard to say it's stupid when it worked out how it did.
Yeah, but at the same time, like,
it's risky.
It's very risky.
Yeah,
very risky.
All right, so let's go to NC State now. So you're at NC State.
Yeah.
You're there 4 years. Did you start all 4 years?
Started all four.
Wow.
And
the starting left back, your cousin left. Yeah.
He left. Uh-huh. So I started all 4 years. I'll never forget the first ACC game we played UNC at home.
Mm-hmm.
It was like the greatest experience. We lost 2-1, but it was a great game. We were, we lost 1-0. We didn't lose 2-1. We lost 1-0. The stands were full. We had like those people in like the like there's a parking deck like behind like kind of behind the stadium. They were like up in the parking deck watching.
How many people did the stadium hold?
It didn't hold. Well, now it holds more. So they put people behind the goals. I think maybe like now maybe close to 5 or so.
That's sick. Yeah. That's,
I think I could be completely wrong.
Yeah.
I haven't been there in a while.
But a few thousand.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They've done a lot of renovations.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, my time there was good. We my sophomore year and my junior year, we struggled big time. We had a lot of internal problems. Mm-hmm. And senior year, we were decent. We were good.
Uh-huh. After your senior year, you said that you graduated early.
Yeah.
That's a smart move. You went from being a little reckless in high school to making some smart decisions.
Yeah, yeah.
So you graduated and dropped out right at the right time. Where did you go as soon as you were done with that semester?
So as soon as I was done, I went back to Baltimore. Was just kind of preparing, training, trying to get right for trials and stuff. Mm-hmm. I went to a couple combines. And so for me at the time, I wasn't a green card holder. Mm-hmm. So I would count as a international player.
Yeah.
So in my mind, I was like, it's going to be tough. I had a couple options within the States, like to go for trials, mm-hmm. Like preseason and stuff like that, but it wasn't anything concrete, you know, like.
Yeah. So with MLS or USL?
No, NASL.
Oh, NASL.
NASL and USL.
Okay. You didn't have any, like, what about the combine, like MLS votes for that?
So I trained with Sporting KC the summer of my senior year. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of crazy. Like, I remember I went back to NC State after I graduated. I went back in, like, January, just for a weekend.
Uh-huh.
And I spoke with the coach, and he was like, I went to the Seattle Sounders had like a combine. Mm-hmm. I did fairly well, but I got injured, so I didn't get to finish the combine. Mm-hmm. And so, long story short, I speak with the coach, college coach, and he's like, yeah, I got off the phone with KC. Mm-hmm. I think they're going to draft you in a supplemental round.
Uh-huh.
So I'm like, oh, this is perfect. Like,
yeah.
I'm gonna go to preseason with them. It's going to be great. And I didn't get drafted.
Uh-huh.
They drafted another one of my teammates.
Really?
Yeah, but I mean, and because we all three, it was three of us that went uh-huh. in that summer. Mm. And he also, I mean, he did really well. And so I was kind of bummed about that. I was like, dang, I thought I was going to get drafted.
Yeah. Were you just watching the draft at home, like on TV?
No, I actually was. So I was driving back to Baltimore from North Carolina.
Okay.
And I wasn't gonna look at it.
Okay.
I wasn't gonna look at it. I got back, and then my coach actually called me, and he was like, he asked if I'd gotten like a call or email, like invitation just to join for preseason. I was like, no, I haven't.
Mm-hmm.
But so then like I really started to like ramp up my, you know, process of trying to find a club.
Yeah.
So my dad, it actually came through my dad. My dad helped me out. He helped contact some agents, mm-hmm. send out highlight videos, stuff like that. And one agent contacted me. He was like, would I be interested in going to England to League One? They were in League One at the time, Crawley Town. Mm-hmm. So I was like, yeah, of course I'd go to England.
Yeah.
But at the time, I had already said I would go to Finland on trial with a club. So I just like, you know what, England, Finland, it's a no-brainer.
Yeah.
Going to England. So I go there, was there for a while, training, did well, but they didn't sign me. And so then the coach at the time, John Gregory, he was like, I like you, but right now it just doesn't make sense, timing-wise.
Mm-hmm.
Go here, Whitehawk FC, in the conference, play there for 2 months, mm-hmm. come back for preseason in the summer, we'll see how it goes. And I was like, all right, perfect. This is
a
good setup, because it was like, close to them, and I was like, this is great.
And conference play is still really high level.
It's high level, and it's a different type of game. It's very rough.
Yeah, gritty. That's what's sort of,
It's just very different. But it's good. And so he ends up having some sort of heart condition, and he steps down, and he doesn't coach anymore. So that opportunity just went out the window. The preseason opportunity went out the window. So
that
then
sucks.
Start over again. Mm. And this is where my journey really starts to like go like way where like meet so many different agents, people uh-huh. saying they can promise you this, that.
Yeah.
So I go on like a whole bunch of like different like invitational trials.
Were you with Whitehawk like for the end of the season until the end of the season?
Okay. So the season, I think it ended like May 1st, because mm-hmm. it doesn't go as long as the Premier League season. Uh-huh. So it ended like May 1st. So
and you did well? You liked it there?
Actually, honestly, I didn't do too well.
Really?
To be completely honest, I did not do too well. It was tough for me because I was traveling from London all the way to Brighton. Mm-hmm. And I just wasn't...
For training?
For training, for games.
Wow.
So like I take the train.
Keep going. I'm just gonna
restart this. Orpington Station. From Orpington, somebody would pick me up. From there, we'd drive, and it'd be the same process. And so it was a lot on me. And I was young. I was away from family. My head just really wasn't in it.
Yeah, yeah.
So my performance sometimes wasn't so good. I was very inconsistent. Like I'd have a great day, and I have a bad day. I have a great day, I have a bad day.
It's a typical like. Your first season abroad, though, like that's typical of like everyone. So, where were you? You were living in. Why were you living in London, not in Brighton?
So that's where I had family, and they weren't going to provide housing because I mean it was only for 2 months.
Yeah.
Because I didn't go to England until February, mm-hmm. and I left Crawley Town in March.
What's that mean?
There's a bug above your head. It's really annoying. There's
Get
that's
that.
The one that she's been playing with.
Alright.
Sorry.
Start the podcast.
Right above your head. No, you just made a mark on there.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's fine. God. Alright, so you were there for 2 months.
Yeah, so they weren't gonna provide housing for someone to be there for 2 months in the season, so it was and they didn't really need me. It was more so like a favor to the other club, you know. Yeah. So I was like, you know what? I'm here. Let's make it work. So I just traveled from London. I stayed with one of my uncles. We'd go from London to Brighton and back.
How long is that? That's like, isn't it like an hour and a half?
Yeah, it was a journey. I'd spend like, how long would I spend on the train? I'd spend like maybe like 40 minutes on the train and the rest would be like 40 minutes in the car or like 35 minutes in the car, something like that. But it was definitely not. I wouldn't recommend it. But again, hindsight, like if you love it, you do it. You do what it takes to, you know, to make it. So I was pleased with at the end. Like looking back, I'm like, I'm glad I did it. But I'm also like, would I go through all that again?
Yeah. You know, it's one at of the beginning. It's the beginning of the career.
Yeah. Thing. So you're kind of like, yeah, I definitely. You know.
Yeah.
So
when I was with Sacramento. Republic just training with them. Mm-hmm. They're like, hey, you can train with us, but you have to play with their affiliate. Their affiliate was in LA, which is a 5-hour drive.
Wow.
So like the weekends I did that drive down and back. Dude, it's one of those things like now if someone said that to me, I'd be like, I'll probably look elsewhere.
Yeah.
But exactly. Like back then it was like, you have to take the opportunity.
Exactly. Exactly.
So season ends and then this is where the opportunity falls through with Crawley, right?
Yeah, with Crawley. And I'm like, at this point, I'm desperate to like stay in England.
Yeah.
I'm looking for like League One, League Two, just anything. Mm-hmm. And it's just not, it's really just not, it's not coming. And one of my teammate at NC State, he was a goalkeeper, he was German. And he was like, yeah, I have this, I know this guy, he's having like this little tour thing where you go and play teams in Germany and play. And I was like, yeah, definitely I'll go. And so the guy told us we'd be playing like third Bundesliga teams, like second teams of first Bundesliga teams. So I was like, okay, this is perfect. Like,
yeah.
And their age, I think they're under 20. They had under 23. So like, all the top teams had under 23 teams, and I was 21, about to turn 22. So I was like, okay, perfect. Like, if I play against these teams, I do well. They can sign me.
Get into a 23 setup, and then move up. Yeah.
So we get there, and it's not what was advertised. We're playing fifth league teams, sixth league teams. We played one team that was, it was Essen, Rot-Weiß Essen. Mm-hmm. We played their second team, I think. And then we played, what's this team? Aue. They're in the second Bundesliga. We played their second team also. And then we played a fourth league team. So those last three games were like the games that like really were the games to play to kind of get something good.
Yeah.
And so I played bad in one of the games. I played really bad in one of the games. And I was like, oh, this is it. So then we play the fourth league team, Auerbach. And I played really well. I played center back that game. and they decided they wanted to keep me. Mm-hmm. So signed there, I played a season there, and that was tough too.
Wait, this is in Germany.
What
division?
Fourth. Regionalliga.
Regionalliga is a good league.
It's a very good league, but it's also like...
It's not professional?
It is and it isn't.
Yeah.
It depends on your club.
Yeah.
Depends on your club. So if your club has a lot of money, you'll be professional because they'll pay you like you are one and you train every day. Mm-hmm. I mean, every morning.
Yeah.
You won't have to go get a job. So for us, it was like half were professional, half weren't professional. Mm. And you still weren't really making like... killing. Some people were making really good money, some weren't making good money.
Yeah.
So we played, we had maybe like, I'd say about 10 of us were probably professional that didn't have another job.
Yeah.
And the others, they did. Some of them were like older players who played like at a higher level, kind of close to the area. So they just, you know, they play for that club. Mm-hmm. Some guys who had played at bigger clubs, but just knew like, they just didn't want to play anymore.
Yeah.
So like they were going to school and playing, so they would like
fourth division. Fourth, fifth division is like a weird.
It's very weird. Yeah. It's very weird, but the quality's there. Yeah. That's the thing. Yeah. The quality is there.
Like the technical, like ta 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 ta.
Exactly.
Like, yeah.
And I said it. I was telling. I think I was telling my brother at the time. Like, I didn't realize how technical Germans are, and I always say it like. Everything about Germany, I say, is efficient.
Yeah.
The players are efficient.
Yeah.
The life is efficient. Mm-hmm. The cars are efficient. Everything they do is just efficient.
Yeah.
And so Germany was it was good and bad. Hard being away from home for so long.
Yeah.
Because at this time, I still hadn't been back to the States.
Yeah. And how long did you go without seeing your mom or dad?
I left 2014. I didn't see them until... Yeah, I saw him I think it was December 2015. Wow. So it was like it's a long time.
So it's like, what, like 2 years, almost 2 years?
Yeah, almost 2 years.
That's a long time. Yeah. It's a long time. I've never, the longest I've ever gone is 9 months.
Yeah, it was pretty crazy.
But were you, and when you were in Germany, did you have like a roommate? Were you living with an apartment there?
So my cousin, who played at NC State, mm-hmm. He signed with the team too.
Okay.
So we lived together.
That's good.
So that was nice.
Sprechen Sie Deutsch?
Ambition.
Ambition.
I haven't been to Germany in a while. Don't test me. Don't test me.
That's all I can do too.
Don't test me.
And ich hätte gern ein Bier. Ich hätte gern ein Bratwurst mit Brötchen. Bitte.
Bitte. Oh my goodness.
Yeah.
But yeah, so that was really good living with him and just having that, you know, having family there, but someone that you could really like, you know, talk to, mm-hmm. kind of, you know, because everyone speaks German. And I mean, some people speak English, but at the same time, you're like, I don't know, it's just weird not having someone familiar.
Yeah, that was my problem, is like my team, 50% of them could speak pretty good English. But like, it's not like the same, because like in the locker room, the jokes are in German.
German, exactly.
And like, you're sitting there, and it's like, oh, somebody will come over and like have to explain what's going on. And you feel like you don't really feel like a part of it.
Exactly.
And then like, even with the jokes, like you can't make the same jokes that you make in America or in England, because it's like the humor, it's like
completely
off.
Different.
Yeah.
Completely
and
different.
So it's like your all your conversations are very surface level. You
exactly.
know? It's like, oh, yeah. You have a brother and sister? Okay, cool. What do you do? Oh yeah, you're a carpenter. Okay.
Yeah, exactly.
And
exactly.
then you kind of just sit there.
Exactly. But for me, I felt like I always got closer to the younger guys, mm-hmm. just because they either like they had just learned English in school, mm-hmm. or like they were also like trying to find their place, because mm-hmm. they were just like either just come to the team and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So everywhere I go, it's typically like the new guys, younger guys that I typically kind of fall in line with, just because I guess it's just easier because they speak the best English.
Yeah,
and they want to know more. Mm.
So you're there for a whole season, huh?
A whole season.
How did you play?
I played. It was again another off and on season for me. Mm. I started off starting, and then this is where I really realized how the professionals like how to be a professional, and you know how. You can really lose your spot instantly. Mm-hmm. I started the first game. I didn't start the second. I played well the first game. I didn't start the second game. And then I was supposed to start that the third game, and I, was it my hamstring or my quad? It was my hamstring or my quad, and I pulled it in training. Extra training. It wasn't even like with the guys training. It was like I was doing extra trying to like catch up. And I probably did too much, and I pulled my, it was my quad. I pulled my quad, my left quad. Taking the penalty. I don't take penalties.
Just goofy.
Yeah. So
just, but that's something you wouldn't think that you'd pull a quad.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so so after that, I was like, okay, I'm gonna get back. But the person in front of me was playing, he was playing well. So like now it's like you don't change, especially in the back, you don't change, there's no reason to change. So I go, so it takes me maybe like 3-4 weeks to get back. I finally get back, and I play in a cup game, and I did not have a good game. So then that kind of puts it in their mind like, all right, he's not ready, he's not good enough, whatever the case may be.
You can't trust him. Confirms their choice of the starter.
Exactly. Yeah. So now he's playing. And then I get down a little bit. And so I think it was maybe like 6 games before break. Started training really well, and then I started playing again. So at this point they start using me as a sub, but like at left mid. Or they'd like change formation, play 3 in the back, and I'd be a wing back. And so like it was a way to kind of, I guess, get me into the lineup, kind of rewarding like my good play in training. And I was playing really well in the games, but the team was kind of struggling a bit. We weren't doing too well, so they fired the coach. We left for break, they fired the coach. So I'm like, okay, now I gotta, you know, come back and try again. Go to preseason in Turkey, had a really good preseason. And then not starting again. And the team's doing well. So then it's like, how do you break the lineup again? So the guy in front of me, like he was a real professional. I was more athletic, obviously had more potential, but he'd been a seasoned pro. He knew his position, he knew his job, he knew he was good at, he knew it wasn't good at.
He wasn't gonna lose his spot.
So exactly. Yeah. So like he was doing everything right until it was a couple games where played a couple fast wingers and it was just he just couldn't keep up. So then it was like, okay, what are we gonna do? They made a little lineup adjustment, started playing again. But I think that year we played maybe, I'd say, 28 games or so. And I only got to play like 12 league games and like, 12 league games, maybe like 1 or 2 cup games. So it was it was just a real like off and on year.
That's something that a lot of people don't, like a lot of people don't, that haven't been pros don't understand, is one, like what you said, how quick you can lose a spot.
Yeah.
How hard it is to get it back. How much competition there is.
Yeah.
And a lot of times it's like not even like who's better. It's like, okay, like what you said, he's experienced, but he's slower. You know, but he's a seasoned pro.
And he knows
this guy's, you know, younger, faster, great player, but he doesn't have the 10 years of experience playing pro this guy has.
Exactly.
And the third string guy, maybe a little bit weaker on some aspects, but he's 5 inches taller than all these guys.
Exactly.
So it's like, it's not like, you know, at the youth level where it's clear night and day, first string, second string.
Exactly.
It's like you have everybody that's like here.
Exactly.
With different characters, like strengths and weaknesses. Yeah. And you're like, okay, well, this game, let's go a little bit more athletic. Let's go with this guy.
And then they start looking at pairings too. So they start looking at like who works better together. This guy and this guy work better together. Well, we're going to keep him there. And then another thing was too, like, I didn't speak German.
Yeah.
So in the back, a lot of directions in German. But everyone spoke English and I could say stuff in English, but it just. It's something about just when you speak their language, it's a lot easier.
You couldn't go, links.
I would. Actually, I started doing that. Yeah.
Give gas.
But it just, I mean, I fought it so hard. I didn't want to learn German. I just wasn't in the right frame of mind. And then when I finally decided, try to learn German, try to do it, it was too late at that point, you know?
So season came to a close. This is, what year is this now when it ended?
This is, I'm not leaving, I think it's the summer of 2015.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, summer of 2000.
I didn't even ask, what city were you in Germany?
Summer 2015. So I was in, it's called Araba.
Araba.
It's like East Germany. It's about an hour and a half from Dresden, an hour and a half from Leipzig,
mm-hmm.
And 2 hours from Prague.
Okay.
So I was like way east.
Mm-hmm.
And we went to Prague a few times. It wasn't the best environment either. It was very, very German.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like there wasn't a lot of people speaking English. There weren't a lot of people who were welcoming.
Yeah.
But then there were. So it was like there was a few, but they're like, you come out in the street and like they know you're not from here.
Because you're smiling at people.
They just know, like, all right, this person doesn't belong here.
Yeah.
There weren't a lot of black people in that area either. So like it was very, very, it was very difficult. Like if I was in Berlin, if I was in Chemnitz, Dresden, Frankfurt, anywhere else, completely different experience.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah. I think it ended 2015.
And then what happened after the season? What'd you do?
So that was a tough time. So after that, I came back to the States. Oh, so sorry. Before that, in the winter, I was trying to leave.
Okay.
I was really trying to leave. Mm-hmm. So I was looking at, when I came back home, I sat down, they were Carolina Railhawks at that time, NCFC. Mm-hmm. I sat down with the assistant, Dwan Bader at the time, and I was trying to get onto the team. And so he was like, yeah, we could definitely, you know, we could try and get you on. This is what we could do, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to figure out, you know, if I can get my release from my team or what the case may be, blah, blah, blah. And it just kind of didn't work out. I was like, yeah, summertime, when your contract's over, come see us.
Mm-hmm.
Wanted to go train with them. And I was hoping to sign with them, got offered a contract, and it just wasn't what I...
Like what you needed?
Yeah. And so I was just like... And I was having my son at the time, and I was like, I just can't...
Yeah.
It's
not going to work out.
But I look at it again, I'm like, if I go back, I would take it. Because I didn't play for the next six... I didn't play until January. So like for those 3 months,
mm-hmm.
I wasn't playing anyway.
Yeah, yeah.
And then I wasn't working.
Yeah, so...
So...
Any income's better than no income.
Exactly. Yeah. You see what I'm saying? So...
But it's hard because you don't know that's going to happen.
Exactly. And I'm sitting there thinking like, okay, I just played a season... I'd find something else. Yeah. And I was getting calls back in Europe, but I was like, I want to stay in the States. And so I turned stuff in Germany down. I had a team in Spain. I turned them down.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, I'm gonna make it work.
Yeah.
And it just didn't work out. And then after that, because I didn't have a green card, I could only stay in the States for 3 months at a time, 90 days.
Oh, yeah.
So I went back to England.
Uh-huh.
Was in England for a little while and came back.
Mm-hmm.
And I went to Newcastle. I was training with I don't even know what league, maybe it was like sixth or seventh league team, just playing, trying to stay fit, Sunday league type environment.
Mm-hmm.
And then.
How hard is it to stay dedicated when you're in a Sunday league type environment?
Terrible. It's terrible. Because you lose focus, you lose ambition.
Yeah.
You're around people that don't want to pursue it.
Mm-hmm.
So you're kind of like, well, why? Like, they don't care, why do I care type of thing.
Yeah.
It could be a toxic environment. And so after that, I left, I came back home, and I really contemplated stopping.
Mm-hmm. Is this, what year is this? Is this still 2016?
This is the end of 2015.
Oh, 2015, okay.
So I contemplated stopping. And then I got a call about would I want to go to Sweden.
Uh-huh.
I was like, yeah, sure, I'd definitely love to go to Sweden. And I was just, then I was like talking with my girlfriend, and I was talking with my family, and I was like, okay, yeah, I'll go to Sweden. But then the agent who I was speaking to was like, I can bring you to Czech Republic, First League.
Mm-hmm.
I was like, no brainer. I'm gone.
Yeah, firstly,
So January of 2016, I went. And so this is where I say, like, the business, the agent business, is so sketchy. I meet up with the guy. He puts me in like a hotel, a nice hotel. Like he's taking care of me. Like he pulls up in the Mercedes, and I'm like, all right, so this guy's legit.
Yeah.
So he's driving me, and he's like, we're like talking a little bit. We're talking about like my experience in Germany. He's like, oh yeah, he speaks German, he speaks French, he speaks like maybe 7 languages, and he really could speak them. And he was like, yeah, you know, like I know Rogan Agency, like those people are my friends, blah blah blah. Mm-hmm. And like he'd call up somebody, and like I'm like, oh, maybe he does know him, like,
yeah,
like kind of like selling me on this.
Yeah, yeah.
But again, I don't know what he was saying. He was speaking German, so you know, like he could have just been having a regular conversation about food.
Yeah.
You know, like I don't know. So so it comes time for me to go train with this team, Jnoimo. And he's like, yeah, so we'll go tomorrow morning. So this is the first red flag. Wake up in the morning. Oh, they're going to camp. So you're going to have to train with the under 19s. It's like, okay, cool. I was like, all right. He was like, so you do well, then they'll fly out to the camp. And I was like, all right. Now I'm like questioning it. Like, they're not, you know what I mean? Like, I'm training with kids. I get there. It's not even that team. It's like a sister team, like brother team, whatever, like a feeder club to them.
It's the U19 of the feeder
team? Of the feeder club.
Okay.
And so, but I get in there, and it's like the facility, and I meet with a guy who, you go to his office, and it's like, you see like a photo of Peter Cech, Nedved, like all these type of guys, like, and he had worked with the national team before. Signed jerseys, pictures, and I'm like, oh, well.
Yeah.
It's like he just did enough to kind of sell the dream.
Just to keep on stringing you along?
Exactly. So then he was telling about all these players he had that play at Sparta Prague, like this and that. And so he goes, all right, so what I want you to do is go train with this team. So I'm training with some team in like the third league. And so then he calls me randomly one day and is like, I have this club that's interested in you in the first league, but just come with us this week, and we're going to go watch Sparta Prague in the Europa League. And I was like, oh, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
So he got us like really good seats.
Uh-huh.
And like, because he really was like, he really knew one, like he was the agent of one of the players. Uh-huh. I don't know if he was really the agent or like a friend or whatever it was, but like they had an actual relationship.
He did have some connection to the...
They had an actual relationship. So we had good seats. We were like enjoying it. And then I was like, so am I going to the club? He was like, yeah, next week. So at this point, I like called the guy who was talking about Sweden. He's like, yeah, I'm ready to go to Sweden.
Yeah.
I was like, well, that deal's gone. I'm like, golly, like, what am I going to do?
Yeah.
I'm stuck in a situation. So I'm just like, all right, you know what? I'm going to train here and keep training. Something's going to come.
Mm-hmm.
And I think like 2 days later, I got a call about going to Romania, second league. It's like the team is like really, really interested.
Mm-hmm.
That they want you bad. This is how much they can pay. This is what's going to go on, blah, blah, blah. But they want to see you first. They're not going to sign you without seeing you. And I was like, are you sure it's the exact team? I was like, he's like, yes. He was like,
and not the U19 of some feeder club.
I was like, they're in the second league. He's like, yeah. He was like, do you know Kibu who played for Inter Milan? I was like, yeah. It's like, it's his like father's club. Like, his father's club.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, okay, perfect. I'll go. So as I'm like packing my bags and getting ready, I get another call about a team in Finland, top league, that wants me to come for trial the week after.
Okay.
So I'm like, okay, perfect. Go to Romania. If it doesn't work out, go to Finland. And so I didn't even tell the guy I was leaving.
At Czech Republic?
I didn't even tell him I was leaving. Uh-huh. Packed my bags, got on the bus. I took a bus from Czech Republic to Romania.
How long was that bus ride?
It was like 15 hours. Went through Bulgaria. Like, I went through all these countries. Like, I literally, like, I was like, you know, I'm not. So on my way there, once I finally got to Romania, and I finally got to the club, I called the guy, and I was like, yeah, you know, like, I got an opportunity in Romania, I'm leaving, blah, blah, blah. And he was like, what? Like, getting real upset about it. And I was like, look, man, like, you've been stringing me along. I had an opportunity, so I just went. And then, so I trained the first day, did it really well, and I was like, yeah, I'm definitely going to sign here.
Mm-hmm.
Like just seeing like the environment, like the players, and like I was like, there's no way they won't sign me.
It's funny after the one day you can tell the vibe of like if the coach is interested, how like it's going, if you're gonna sign. It's really funny after like one day you have such a good.
But I knew the money wasn't good.
Yeah, yeah.
And so I was like, do I run the? I was like, Finland's not going to pay me a lot more, but do I run the risk of saying no? And I was like, I haven't played in 6 months.
Yeah.
It's a professional team. Mm-hmm. It'll get me back to where I need to go. So sign. So like 2 days later, I signed and I called the guy in Finland like, thank you so much, but I have this opportunity. I got a contract, direct contract, and I'd rather take the contract than run the risk of a trial. He was like, yeah, I understand, blah, blah, blah. And so I signed, and after I signed, I'm like, all right, perfect, this is it. I'm here, like, so I'm talking to some of the guys, and I'm like, how long have you been at Baba? And it's a whole, like, it's a completely new team.
Everybody's new.
Everyone's new, like, that half of the season. So I'm starting to wonder, like, because they play from May till June. May till June 1st. I mean, not May, sorry, from August till June.
It's like a short season.
Yeah, it's like May, June. I was like, August till June.
Yeah.
And so I was like, this is going to be, it's going to be an interesting season. Like, everyone's new. And so, like, then I started thinking, like, wait, hold on. Why is everyone new? And then one player came back he was there this half season before, and he started telling me, like, they didn't pay the salaries. They didn't do this. They didn't do that. That's why everyone left. He's like, that's why I left. I went on trial with the first league team. They didn't sign me. I need to play, so I'm back.
Yeah.
I was like, what did I just get myself into?
Yeah.
And then I was talking to the director. I was like, he was like, yeah, trust me, they'll pay. They'll pay. They know why. That's why they signed everyone for less money, blah, blah, blah. They'll pay.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, cool. I was like, because it's not a lot of money, but I need that money.
Yeah.
Romania is really, really cheap. It's dirt cheap. You could literally, like, you could, for a month, like, on groceries, you could spend $50.
Which, that's nice.
Like, and you could, like, really enjoy it. Like, not like, oh, you're spending $50 and kind of, like, picking and choosing. You can get what you really want.
Dang.
So I was there, and then 1 month goes by. We haven't won a game. I don't even think we scored.
Really?
I don't think we scored. We played, like, 4 or 5 games. We haven't scored. Comes to payday. No money. So we're like, wait, what about the money, blah, blah, blah. Oh, yeah, it's coming next week. We'll speak to Rufa, the boss Rufa. He'll pay the money, blah, blah, blah. Okay, cool. A week goes by, no money. Another week goes by, no money. The guys are like, we're not getting paid.
Yeah.
You're starting to realize, like, you're not going to get paid. So then play another month, start asking about the money. We haven't won a game also. So, like, that doesn't help the case
either. Yeah, because they're like, why are we going to pay you?
Exactly. But again, like, I start to look at the team, and I'm like, we're probably never going to win a game because they started dropping players and started playing under 19 players in games because I think 2 or 3 teams in the league were automatically going down because of money issues.
Uh-huh.
So they were safe.
Oh.
So he didn't want to pay anybody. He didn't want, because he just wanted to play out the games. And just come back next season. And so they, like, dropping players, and, like, people, like, a lot of people were, like, starting to have issues. Like, my roommate at the time played for the Azerbaijan national team. And he was just, like, he just wasn't having it. He was causing a storm. He was, which rightfully so, like, you're not getting paid.
Yeah, it's been 2 months now.
Yeah, like, I mean, I was angry. I was always talking to, like, the director, the press, trying to, like, figure it out, like, what's going on, like, when are you getting paid? And then they tell you lies like, oh, like, the city owns this half, like, half the team. They haven't paid their money, so we can't really, you know.
It's not our fault.
We don't have it. Da, da, da. They start making all these excuses.
Yeah.
I'm like, okay, cool. So, like, he just calls a fit, and he leaves. But he gets them to pay for his flight ticket and give him some money, and he goes. And I was like, Like, that's probably, like, the only way you're going to get any sort of money or anything out of this is if you, like, threaten to leave or something, and, like, so, but in my mind, I was like, I need to play some games.
Yeah.
So I kind of had it in my mind that, like, okay, like, we only had, like, maybe, like, 12 games left. But, like, just, like, see out the games.
Good. You, at that point, it was more important to get games than it was to.
Yeah, so I was like, it's like, just see out the games, you know, like.
Yeah.
And then at the end, just try and ask.
Yeah, keep going.
Just ask for them to maybe just pay your flight ticket back home, or, you know, like, something like that. something that will help you out. So I'm playing the games, I'm playing well, which is, it was actually pretty good. We played one team, Ucluj, and they played in Cluj Arena, which is like 60,000.
Wow.
Obviously, they didn't have 60,000. Yeah,
but still, that's a cool... Then,
so like, it was like a really good stadium. And like that same year, Spain played Romania in that stadium.
Mm-hmm.
So like, it was... Like, just to say, like, the level was really good.
Yeah.
And so, last couple games come around, and so, like, they start, like, players are starting to, like, leave, and you're wondering, like, what's going on, like, and one player got, he got his flight ticket paid, and he got, like a month's salary or something, and they let him go, and so it was, like, threatening to tell the Federation. So, like, I got into it with, like, the coach, the president, the director, like, kind of, like, you know, what's going on with my money, blah, 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 this and that. Like, I'm going to threaten to tell the president, I mean, the board, this, that, FIFA, and all that type of stuff. And it didn't really work out for me because it was bad blood between me and the coach now. And, like, the like, everything just, like, the relationship got sour. But in the end, they ended up paying. They didn't pay for my flight ticket, but they gave me, like, a month's pay.
Mm-hmm. Better than nothing.
So I was like, you know what, perfect. Just let me get out of here.
Yeah.
So then I go back to the States, and at this time I'm still only here for like 90 days. So I'm trying to figure out, like, trying to go and try with teams and like stuff like that, so I can, you know, play somewhere and get all that like situated, and go back to North Carolina SC, because I'm always in like Raleigh, like down south. So I was training with them, and I don't know how long I was training with them for. I was training for a little while, and then I think I got, did I get hurt? I got hurt. I pulled my hamstring.
Uh-huh.
Like, just terrible luck. Pulled my hamstring.
Yeah.
And then I just decided, and then like at that point, I was kind of in the phase of like, all right, this is probably, again, like, I'm probably going to be done, da, da, da. And then, again, calls about trials and stuff come up.
Where do you keep getting all these calls? Just from, like, your, is it from your dad reaching out over?
No, at this point, like, I had also, like, reached out to so many agents during this, like, process. I'd go on, like, at that one point, FIFA had, like, an agent, like, a list of agents. Contact. I go to countries. It'd be, like, my job every day, contact agents. Yeah. Sent, like, and then other like websites, like what was the one, I forget what it was, I like made like an account, like player profile, and like to this day I'll still get random calls from agents just from like that stuff still being up there.
Yeah.
And so I got a call about going to Finland second league, and I was like, perfect. I was like, I'm gone, that's what I need, da da da. So I go. Another terrible decision. I found another club that didn't pay salary.
And usually, I feel like Finland and Sweden and Norway are usually pretty good with that.
But I ended up not signing.
Yeah.
Actually, the crazy thing is, Idrisi played for that team.
Really?
OPS.
Really?
Yeah. Idrisi played for that team.
Huh. All right.
But he wasn't there when I went there, but he actually played for that team.
That's funny. This is such a small world.
It's crazy.
Yeah.
We were joking about it like a couple weeks ago.
Mm. Idrisi was one of our teammates at Tulsa.
Yeah.
Oh, he'll be on the podcast. I can't wait for his podcast.
Yeah, his will be interesting.
It's going to be interesting counting the years with his age.
So from there, I went to... So I was there, and I just... After, like, I was there on trial for like a month, like a super long trial.
Mm.
And I just said, this is enough. Like, they're not paying salaries. What's the point? Like, I'm only on trial. Like, I'm not staying here. And I left, and then after that season, they actually, like, a lot of players reported them to the Federation, and they're no longer a club. Like, they, I think they had to, like, pay everyone, like, pay all the players, and then, like, they had to pay, like, fines and stuff for not paying on time and this and that, and so now they're no longer a club, which is, I mean, karma, like, serves you right, in my opinion. So from there, I left there, and this is where... I went to Egypt. I went to Egyptian Premier League team.
Uh-huh. And that, again, this is from just an agent on the list that
just called,
had a connection and
just called me.
Yeah.
Like, the Egyptian. One day I'm going to show you my phone, like,
yeah.
Of just like, if you go on my phone, it has like, I have, if you type an agent in my contacts, mm-hmm. it'll be like 50
that's,
agents.
Dude, that's the thing that people don't realize though, too, with like your other, you're a footballer, like you train, you work out, you eat. The other job is contacting.
Yeah.
Like it's literally never, like you said, your day it's job, never, you just send emails, ending. Calls.
Never ending.
Yeah.
So.
And what month and year is this now going to Egypt?
This was 2000, was this, I think Egypt was 2017.
Okay.
Yeah. Was it? Yeah. Egypt 2017.
Uh-huh.
So I went to Egypt. I was in Egypt that summer. And so I was there for a week.
Uh-huh.
I was there for a week. And I really enjoyed it, actually.
Yeah.
It was the team had just got promoted. And I went in there. Was playing really well. I played, and then I was training, playing a couple of training, like 11v11 games, and they had a match the next day, and I was supposed to play, like 50 minutes,
mm-hmm.
and the coach just didn't play me. He didn't play me. Like maybe like last 20 minutes, he put me on,
uh-huh.
and I was so angry. I was like,
yeah,
and he played me at center back, and I mean I like playing center back too. But I promise you, like, that's probably the best 20 minutes I've played in my entire life.
Uh-huh.
Not one wrong pass, didn't get beat.
Yeah.
Perfect, like, diagonal, but everything, like, it was...
Everything clicked, everything
just
was
just a straight,
right.
clean game, but it was out of frustration.
Yeah.
And so then he calls me over. He was like, yeah, come to training tomorrow. So we go to training, me and another guy. And you can just tell, like, when you've played well, the reception by the players also.
Yeah.
Because prior to that, like, they were talking to me, not really, but after that, like, players get my number, like, mm-hmm. talking to me, like, oh, like, why'd you come to Egypt? Like, oh, are you going to stay? Like, what situation? Yeah, yeah. Like, talk to the coach yet?
That's
like,
the best feeling, too, when so the like, players accept you.
It's like, in my mind, I'm like, okay, perfect. Like, I'm definitely going to sign here. This is, like, Egyptian Premier League. After this, like... In my mind, I already start like putting in my head like people go from Egyptian Premier League to the English
Everybody
Premier League.
Does the
like
path, yeah.
I'm like, oh, this is perfect. Like I can go so many places from here.
Yeah.
Come to find out, they only had 3 more international spots, and they signed a striker
mm-hmm.
on the last spot. They signed a striker
like right before you.
They signed him like maybe like a day or two after I trained after the game and like the agent was kind of talking about the contract blah blah blah, but like the striker played like in the World Cup or something. It was like I don't know if they World Cup or like African Nation Cup, something like that, mm-hmm. you know, and he was like a good striker, so they were like, yeah, we'd rather get a striker than a left back / center back.
Yeah.
And I was like, oh my, again, like
another thing that fell through that didn't work out. Yeah.
And so like now the agent's like kind of scrambling. He's like, yeah, I have this team in Alexandria, in Egypt, which is like the nice part. So like now I'm like, okay, yeah, it's gonna be perfect. So like, the beaches are.
Uh huh.
And he's like, but just give me a couple of days. And then he comes back and he's like, well, I got this team in the second league, and I'm like, and the thing is like Egypt isn't. It's not that nice. Like, it's like Cairo is not nice.
Yeah.
It's really not. It's not like a beautiful city. Like Alexandria, like by the beaches, that's really beautiful. But like uh-huh. Cairo's like, it's kind of dirty. Like, and I just really wasn't enjoying it. Like, I was staying with the agent at the time.
Uh-huh.
And like, he had like roaches in the apartment. I stayed there one night. And I was like, I can't do this. Going to a hotel. Kind of like the hotel was really nice, and I was like, definitely living beyond my means at that point.
Yeah.
But it was really, and I was like, I just couldn't deal with like living with roaches, like staying with roaches,
yeah.
like
yeah.
It was like really roach infested, like.
Bro,
I just it gives me like,
yeah,
I'm
I don't
shaking
like
like
that.
Thinking about
I don't
it.
Like that.
So then from there, I. My last couple of days, I knew I was going to leave. I didn't know where I was going at that point, though, but I knew I was going to leave.
Uh-huh.
So I went to go see the pyramids.
uh-huh.
And the thing was, so I went to go see the pyramids, and I guess I got there too late that day. I think they were trying to hustle me, and they got like my friend who was there.
Yeah.
They were like, yeah, it's closed, but if you want to go, we'll give you a camel ride. You have to pay like X amount. And I was like, it's like, no. I was like, I'll take pictures from here. But like, it was far. You can see like, yeah, those are the pyramids, but like, yeah. It's not like I'm like here, like taking something, you know what I mean? Like, I wish I would have like paid, cause it's like, when else am I going to be in Egypt?
Yeah.
So, I should have did it. But oh, well, maybe I'll go back another time.
That sounds like a scam, though.
Yeah, and that was the thing. Yeah. It was like, and it had like a gate, like, it had like a gate, and it was like kind of closed. And I'm like, so we pay them this money, and then they still kick us out, and like, what? Like, what happens? You know, like, but it would have been good to just have another story. So I go back to the hotel, and I'm like trying to figure out what I'm gonna do. And one of the agents who I'd spoken to like a long time ago was talking about me going to Slovenia. And I was like, it's like Slovenia. Like, let me call him. Like, let me see what I was like hounding him. Like, what's up with that team in Slovenia? Second league? Like,
yeah.
Are they still interested? Da, da, da. He was like, yeah. He's like, I'm not sure. Let me call him. So yeah, they're interested. Next day, book a flight, gone. Going to Slovenia. So now I'm in Slovenia.
This sounds like, bro, it's insane. Like,
it's like a map on the screen.
I know, honestly. There needs to be a map. Go ding, ding, ding.
So, like, now I'm in Slovenia, and I'm like, I'm sitting there, I'm like, this is complete culture shock, because it's like, you go from Egypt to Slovenia, it's like,
completely
different. Yeah. And it's cold and rainy, and like, in Egypt, I was in shorts.
Yeah.
I'm like, and the thing is, like, I'm traveling, like, I'm planning on staying there for the next 6 months. So I have a suitcase and a duffel bag and a backpack. So I'm like, so everywhere I'm going, like, people are looking at me like,
that's not, dude, I hate that.
But like, but I had to be prepared. Like,
There's no other way. Stay. So like, you can't bring a duffel bag with one pair.
Like, yeah, you know, so like, I'm prepared to stay. So I'm there for like, I'm in Slovenia for a week. So the first couple of days training, do well. And I'm like, all right, so this level is not high.
You said second league?
Yeah, I'm like, this level is not high at all. But, and I saw them play a game. And I'm like, okay, yeah, I'll sign here. I'll play here. I'll get out.
Yeah.
They had a lot of guys on loan from like the top league and then some clubs in Croatia. The team Maribor that plays, I think they play Europa League.
Mm-hmm.
They had two strikers from there. And they were actually, they were really good. They had like individual talent was there, but overall quality wasn't.
Yeah.
So I'm like, okay, yeah, I'm definitely gonna sign. Come the next training, kill it, and I'm like, yeah, this is easy.
Yeah.
This is real easy. And then it's like, yeah, we want to do your like medical, like whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And like, I had pulled my quad before, and like I had like kind of like a lump.
I have that.
Like
I still have that.
Like, yeah,
like when I was 13.
I had like a lump.
Yeah.
And like, but I wasn't feel like I hadn't been feeling like right.
Uh-huh.
Like I'd been like having pain there and da da. But I've like just been sucking it up. So do the medical and they're like, yeah, like something's wrong with your quad. Da da da.
Mm-hmm.
Like we're not signing an injured player.
Mimi's laughing.
And I'm like,
at this point, man, just go home.
Yeah. I'm like, no, I'm fine. Da, da, da. They're like, well. They're like, come back, like, get it fixed, come back, blah, blah, blah. So I go back home.
Uh-huh.
And at this point, I'm like, yeah, I was like, all right, I'm done playing. I was like, I'm
like
done.
Like what Mimi just said, like, at this point, go home.
Yeah, I went home. I was like, I'm done playing.
Yeah.
That's it.
What year are we on? Like,
this is like September 2017.
Uh-huh.
It's like, I'm done. Actually, it's a little bit before September, but like, I'm done playing.
Yeah.
So now I'm home trying to just figure stuff out. Not training, went to go check my quad, checked out, everything was okay, kind of, sort of, but just, I was like, whatever, I'm not playing anyway, like, I'm just going to play for fun.
Yeah.
So my old coach, my first ever coach, he taught me everything I knew, had like a men's league type team, and he was like, yeah, he's just trying to like help guys out, if you want to come and play. I was like, yeah, sure, I'll play. So I like was doing it for fun, and then I met this guy. His name is Jay, and I still talk to him to this day. He's like a really good guy. He started up they're in the UPSL now. Uh-huh. He started up a club there in UPSL, and he offered me a job, and so I was working with him, became a PRP counselor, and I was like completely like just done with playing.
Yeah.
As you start playing again, you start
like, and when you start doing well, and like
you just, when you haven't like got it out of your system, yeah, you just kind of like, so like I'm training, and I'm playing, I'm working too, like, and I'm like, everything's fine, but like something's still kind of missing, you know, like, so then I get back to really training, like, so I go to like this guy named Derek Phillips, who a lot of us like professionals in the area, or like people aspiring to be professional, train with. So like I'm back training with him, I'm like really getting in shape, I'm really going after it, and now I'm like, okay, like I'm definitely good. Like in my mind I'm like, I'm gonna play.
Yeah.
So now I'm like trying to sort, figure out like what's the next step.
Yeah.
In my mind I'm like, okay, I want to stay in the States, so what's the, like, what's gonna happen? So I'm like, okay, so contact North Carolina FCS, I can come to like an invitational trial. So okay, cool, I can do that.
That's the worst.
But like at that point, I'm like, I really want. So like, and my mindset was like, okay, like I want this bad now. So like, I'm willing to
do anything, any opportunity.
And then I start getting calls about like, so Derry FC in Ireland. They play in the Irish Prem, and then. Yeah, so that was, so it was those two. So I went to, and one of my old college teammates signed there. And so I went there, was there for a week and a half, played, like, it was good. Everything was good. I said I was going for a week and a half, and I was coming back.
Yeah.
I was like, so I went, and now we're talking, like, contract and stuff like that. They said a certain amount before I came, then they offered something else, and I was like, well, I have a job, I have this, I have that.
Yeah.
At this point, it's not worth it.
Yeah.
No, thank you. So like,
wow.
So I was like, I knew what I wanted.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I was like, all right. So I was like, I wasn't gonna take that. And then, especially to like, if it was a team in the States, I probably would have taken that amount. But to be overseas again and have that experience, I was like, nah, yeah, no chance. Yeah. So then I went to. So then I started getting US, like USL opportunities. And I was like, oh, this is I was like, this is what I want. So, yeah. So Julian Myers, agent who I'm with now, he called me and was like, would I be interested in training with Tampa? And Cincinnati.
Oh wow.
But they were in, they were in Tampa going to Bradenton or something like that, or other way around. So he was like, I was like, yeah, sure. He was like, all right, it could happen real quick, so next couple of days be prepared to fly out. It's like, yeah, perfect. And my old college roommate plays for them, and like he's a real good friend of mine, we talk like nearly every day. And I didn't tell him I was coming out yet,
cause yeah.
And so like they said, yeah, come out. So I booked the ticket and I called him like, hey, I'm like, I'm coming out. He's like, really? I was like, yeah. So go there, and I felt like I did well. He like did fairly well, but it was just one of those situations where you have to be exceptional at that point, especially when it's they have a roster, they have someone in that position already. You just have to be exceptional. You can't be on par, you have to be exceptional to get the contract at that.
Which is
that
easier point. Said than done.
Exactly.
Yeah, especially as coming into it as the,
so it's like I did well enough to fit in with the squad, but I just wasn't good enough to take the starting role. So it's like, why do you bring him in?
Yeah, I've heard that so many times.
But it sucks to hear. But when you start to think about it, it's like, it makes sense, because, like, why? Like, they have to justify why they're gonna pay you.
Why would you spend money on a guy?
Why are you gonna
to
pay?
Not be our guarantee, like,
exactly.
Starter.
Yeah. So if you have someone that, in mind that is the starter, and you kind of have someone that could play the backup role, do you really fork out money? You don't have to on a backup. No. So I was there for like 3 days, flew back to Baltimore, and so I was like, all right, cool. Like, I mean, it was an opportunity, I liked it, whatever.
Yeah.
And then I got a call to go to Charleston.
Charleston Battery?
Charleston Battery, like 2 weeks later. And it was like, could you be here on Monday, and it was like Saturday night. No, it was like Sunday. It was like, he kept saying like, oh yeah, be ready.
Yeah.
And it was like Sunday morning. It was like, could you be here? It's like, I had to be there for Monday, and I'm like, looking at flights, and like timing wise, I couldn't make it.
Mm-hmm.
I rent a car and I drive from Baltimore to Charleston.
Oh my. Bro, that is.
But the thing is, like, I think, I don't know what happened. Like, I didn't leave until like, maybe it was like 8 or 9.
Uh huh.
So I literally drove all night to train on Monday.
Oh my God.
Morning.
Good for you.
But like I said, like at that point, I was really like, yeah, I wanted to do it.
Yeah.
So I made the drive. I was there for like 5 days. Kind of similar situation to Cincy. But at the same time, like they had another trialist in, and I did well, but the guy was like, he wanted a center back. He's like, yeah. He sees me more as a left back.
Mm-hmm.
He wants just a pure center back. Mm-hmm. And he was like, if I put you at left back, you'd probably do well. And I was like, yeah. He was like, but we're going to keep, I don't know what the guy's name was. We'll keep him for an extra week. He's been here for a few more days. We'll keep him. And if it doesn't work out, we'll let you know.
Yeah.
I don't know if they signed the guy or not. After that, I was just like, yeah, I'm done with that.
Uh-huh.
So packed the car up, drove back another 15 hours. And I'm like, at this point, I'm like, all right. If it's something, I'm only going if it's in the States or if I have a direct contract.
Mm-hmm.
And I like set my mind on it. I was like, because I told myself, like, I'm giving it until like season starts a little like further. And if not, then I'm completely done playing.
Yeah.
Get a call from, so it was my cousin's agent. My cousin's agent.
Uh-huh.
It was like this team in Sweden, Syrianska, they usually playing Superettan in the second league. They got relegated last year. They had some money issues. They want to go back up. And I'd heard about the club before. I was supposed to go there on trial, like during my time with all these agents and clubs.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, I know that they're known for having like money issues, like not paying on time. But they always pay, but they don't pay on time. And I'm like, I was like, you know what? I'm not going on trial. They were like, but they want to see you on trial first. I was like, I'm not leaving this country without a contract. I was like, so either they can take it or they can leave it.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, they'll do the contract. Then they're like, this amount. I was like, no. I was like, I'm not coming unless I get this amount. I was like, I heard they have money issues. One of my friends played there before and he didn't like it. He didn't get his money, blah, blah, blah. I was like, I need this money, this amount up front as a sign-on fee.
Hard negotiator.
I was making a lot of demands.
At that point, you've done that. Yeah. So it's like that point, like, I'm doing it again.
Yeah,
like,
exactly.
I've been through it.
And like, I was like, you know what? This is it. Like, either they take it or leave it.
Yeah.
And I'm playing like hard, like, and I'm like, this is what I want. They're like, no, we can do this, we can do that. They decide to give me a sign-on bonus. They decide to pay me the money, give me my own apartment. Because what happened was they played their first league game. They were like hesitant. They played their first league game and they lost, and the left back played terrible and he got a red card.
Oh.
So then it was just like, all right, whatever you got to do, bring him in.
Yeah, yeah.
So come to Sweden now. I even forgot. I had a trial set up. I had a trial set up in Estonia Premier League.
Uh-huh.
And
uh-huh.
I was actually like really keen on going to this club because they play Europa League qualification.
Yeah, yeah.
And they always win the league.
Oh, so that would have been a really good setup. Yeah.
And a friend of mine, he played with them and he played against Liverpool.
Wow.
So I was like, this is perfect. Like, yeah. I'll go here.
Uh-huh.
So like, I had that set up for like the following week, and then I just didn't call that agent back. Just didn't say a word to him, and I just went to Sweden, and I didn't say a word to that agent because he was someone, he'd like taken money from me, like it's one of those, like, I, you know what I mean, like, it was a agents bro. It's rough.
Uh-huh.
So like I'd like pay to go like to some invitational trial or something like that, and like, you know, so
yeah.
So yeah, so I decided to go to Sweden. I played there, and so the club was actually, it was pretty crazy because they were in the third league, but they had a lot of guys who just did not belong in that league. Like, guy played in the Swedish national team, mm-hmm. like Uganda national team, just players who played like in the first league in Sweden, the first league in Turkey, like just all over the place. Like, mm-hmm. Actually one of the guys, like a good friend, he's like, me and him are actually good friends now. He played for the Nigeria under 20 team that went to the World Cup.
Wow.
So like, there was a lot of like quality. Of talent, yeah. They paid a lot of money to try and go back up. So like, they invested a lot. And luckily, like, we ended up promoting and going back up.
Mm-hmm.
And they tried to keep a lot of us, but not for the type of, like, the money they wanted was less than they offered the season before. And it was like, we can't do it. And they were like, well, we've spent a lot to go up. We just can't, budget-wise, we can't. So they have a whole new team and wish them the best. But there, too, was I had a little bit of trouble, too, because, like, they weren't paying on time.
Uh-huh.
But, like, it got to the point where, like, late was normal.
Yeah.
So, like, supposed to get paid on, say, the 28th, get one paycheck, everything at once, the 28th of the month or something like that. So started paying it on, like, the 4th of the month. So then it's like, then they started going to like the 7th or whatever. So like now every day it's like the 7th. So like now it's like, okay, supposed to be on the 28th on the contract, but now it's the 7th. So like, you still get it like on the 7th, on the 7th, on the
7th. You just like 2 weeks, like you got the extra 2 weeks where you got to stretch the budget a little
bit further. Like, so but like now, like after like the third time it's happened, it's kind of like, well, like this is the normal day. Yeah. It's become normal. Like that's the day you get paid.
Mm-hmm.
But like even them too, like, A lot of shady stuff was going on with that club, like not playing players because of they want to play like their own like Syrian players so they can do well and then they can sell them on, like just a whole bunch of like shady stuff. And I mean, we had 5 coaches in the year.
Oh my god!
They was just, because like basically the board ran the team.
Yeah.
So they just wanted someone who was like a puppet.
Yeah.
So like they'd have coaches, didn't like them. Fire him. Didn't like him, fire him. This coach was wanted his own thing, fire him. And we had one coach, this guy from Italy. He actually worked with like the AC Milan like youth team. Mm. And he was a really, really good coach. He won 2 preseason games, won 2 league games, and he was giving us like actually actual structure and balance.
Mm.
And after the second game he won, like some of the players didn't like him who like had like good ties in the club.
Yeah.
Got rid of the coach. And I was like,
How do you even play when new coaches coming in like that?
It's honestly, it's madness. And like, I also ran into the same situation too. Like, I came in and obviously like, I didn't know the players. I didn't know like, and I was there for maybe like 3 days, played the game on the weekend.
Mm.
And I was okay. I was all right. And then the next day, the next game, I didn't play. And then I had a little ankle injury and I like struggled to get back in.
Mm-hmm.
But the good thing that saved me was the person who played my position did not do good enough to take the job.
Mm-hmm.
So like when I came back, I had the job and I played the rest of the season. And then like we go to the promotion playoff games and I played maybe 20 games straight.
Uh-huh.
Like, and 2 games before, I scored 2 goals in the game. Like, I was, like, probably one of the greatest games I had. Everything's going well. Come to the first promotional playoff game. Come to the locker room. Like, I don't even check the board because my name's been on the 11. So I don't even think to check it.
You know?
Go sit down. Like, we're all talking. The coach calls me. I'm like, why is coach calling me? Like, it's kind of... And he's like, yeah, you know, just want to let you know that... us on the board, we talked about it. We're going to go with Illich today. And I'm like, huh? He's like, yeah, we think that he's going to be able to handle that winger best. The winger's fast and likes to get forward. And I was like, but he's a left midfielder. He doesn't like to defend. And he's like, yeah, but we think that's best. And I was like, okay, cool. And I just, you know, I just was a professional about it.
Yeah.
Because obviously you want the team to promote because bonuses are at stake. Yeah, exactly. Like, you know, like everyone's winning at the end, and like, I mean, I've played enough games.
At that point, you got 20 games under the belt. Yeah.
So I've played enough games. Like I had a full season. everything's good. I'm like, mm-hmm. you know what, like, just be positive. So I came on in that game maybe like the last 10 minutes, shore up the game. And then the last game, same thing, I came like 30 minutes, shore up the game. And I was perfectly fine with it. But at that point I knew no matter what, I wasn't gonna re-sign there because just kind of like how the coach didn't run the club, the board ran the club.
Yeah.
So you could see it. So when I left there, I was like, all right, I'm gonna play in the States. And I put it in my head that I was like, the only way I'm playing in Europe is if the money's like.
Yeah, it's the perfect setup.
It's like the money's like, you just can't say no.
Yeah.
And luckily, like, I got the call about Tulsa early. Like, uh-huh. I think I got the call before I left Sweden. Like,
so this is like fall.
This was like, yeah. Well, I left Sweden November 18th, 19th.
Mm-hmm.
So I got the call from my agent, like, hey, like, OPSM.
Yeah.
You know, Julian Godwin.
No, who's that?
Oh, you don't know
them? I'm kidding. Okay. Yeah, I know.
So I got the call from them, and they were like, there's interest. Would I be interested? How much would I take? Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Just kind of like trying to like see what could happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I was like, and I like spoke to him like, yeah, that's what I'd like. Da, da, da. Just kind of like, you know, let them know kind of where I stood, what I would like, what I wouldn't like. And so I come back home for about a week and like starting to talk to Julian a little bit more, talk to Godwin a little bit more. And Godwin's like, yeah, it's going to happen really, like could happen like really quickly.
They're
looking to send over a contract. And I was like, I couldn't believe, at that point, I couldn't believe it. Yeah, I was like,
because you've been trying to play in the States for
yeah, forever. I'm like, I'm really about to get this contract. And season just finished. It's about to be the best offseason of my life. I don't have to like.
You don't have to worry of like, where am I going to be next?
Like, I don't have to like call around, like all this, you know, extra stuff. Like,
yeah.
I finally have an agent who can do his job.
Uh-huh.
So then I got the call. I got the call from Godwin that, yeah, they sent over the contract. Saw the contract. And I was like, perfect. Like I was like happy with it. Actually, I wasn't happy with it. Barry and Wayne, I need some more money. No, I was happy with it, and I signed it, and now I'm here in Tulsa.
I've talked to a lot of pros about their story to get to like.
How many teams is that?
Yeah, how many times? Countries, team, I don't know, we can count it up. Count it up later when you get home. Tell me the countries, the number of teams that like you
honestly, because
like.
There's probably some that I just like left out on the way, just like not really thinking, but like I've been to like a lot of like different places for trials and like.
Because that'd be a good title too, to be like, how many countries, how many rejected like teams to like now signing. Like, now you've had a good last year to this year. It's like you're, you know, I don't want to, like, jinx anything, but momentum's, like, knock on wood.
Yeah.
Momentum seems to be going well, so.
Yeah.
That's good. I'm stoked for you. Honestly, it's cool because it's all about, like, not giving up, like, the determination.
Yeah.
Like, you literally were just like, I'm just going to keep going, keep trying. Yeah. And a lot of times, so many people after that first time where it's, like, a bad experience over in some ways, like, I'm done.
Yeah.
I'm stopped.
Yeah.
You're like, either dumb or you're like
that's the thing. Like I start thinking like, am I just an idiot? Like, why do I keep putting myself through this? Like, and like, but at the same time, it's like you love it.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, and you feel like you're so. Every time you feel like you're so close.
Yeah.
And then you hear a story of like a friend of yours or someone you know who was playing here and just got here, and I'm like, and you sit and you're like, how like.
Yeah.
Like it's possible.
Yeah.
It's very possible. So like you just sit there and you're like, all right, so what can I do to get there? Like, how do I get there? So then you go back and you're like, all right, let me start training. Let me start doing this. And to be honest, it sounds, and you're probably going to laugh because we talked about this book today, Relentless.
Yeah, yeah.
But that book is what literally, like, it changed my thinking. Like in 2017, before I went to Sweden.
Mm-hmm.
So like I got that book from one of my like high school friends. He was like, you know, like I'm training. People think I'm crazy because like I should just do something else. But like, he loves playing football. He's trying to, you know, make it. So he's been reading this book, and it's just kind of, like, got his mindset on, like, work ethic and stuff like that. So I was like, you know what, let me pick it up. So I picked it up, and it just, when I started training, I was, like, training with a purpose. Like, I just felt like it just kind of changed my whole mindset.
No, like, it's so funny because I've talked about that book on, like, my videos for a long time. Like, Relentless by, like, Tim Grover. Like, this is the book we're talking about. Relentless by Tim Grover. I've talked about it a ton. It's, like I said, I picked it up, and I'm like...
He has the whole thing, like, sticky noted.
Like little quotes in there, Oh, my God. Freak. I can't... I'm a... It literally just hit me. Like, I was reading it, and I felt like every... Like, I was, like... I was, like, feeling it, but, like, that was all the stuff I hadn't put into words, you know?
Exactly.
It's crazy. Like, this guy... And it's not even by an athlete. I mean, this is just Tim Grover. This is a trainer. And, like, his mindset is just ridiculous. But, like, that book, like, is what, like... You read it at the right time.
Yeah, it, literally the right time. It couldn't have come at a better time. And, like, I would say I've read it maybe 3 times now. Mm-hmm. Like, 3 times full. And, like, every now and then I'll just, like, go to, like, parts and, like, just read the whole thing. Like... Just to kind of like get my mind right again, like
that's why I have a sticky note. Like I can literally have a little tab, like oh, this is the part I need, like to read,
and it's perfect because it's like it just kind of just it just gets your mind going again to like why you do it, how you like you know the process, and the best part I like is you don't have to like something like you don't have to like the work.
Yeah,
you just have to love the result,
crave the end result.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's like
crave what the work gets you.
And the thing is like. It's so simple when you think about it. It's like, what do you want to win? You want championships? You want this? You want that? But how do you get there? You gotta.
But it was crazy because like we hadn't talked about that book, like at all, like not at all. And I literally walked in the training room this morning, right before the podcast, and I saw you have that. And I was like I saw it, and like it hit me, like, oh shit, is that Relentless? Like,
and you saw me in training today.
Yeah. Killing it.
You saw me in training today.
Killing it.
Relentless.
Relentless. Cleaner. Straight cleaner. That's sick. All right, so that's crazy. So I'm, you know, obviously I'm your teammate, so I'm rooting for you. Hope we have a good season.
Yeah.
Hopefully you get, you know, some assists to me. Yeah. I'll be up top scoring.
Hopefully you get some assists to me too.
Yeah. We just cross the field.
That's sick. I'm going to be in the box though, set pieces. I'm tall now. I'm not 5'4 anymore.
Dude, that's the thing. You're like an inch taller than me, so now... I'm the one back.
Sorry, but we can switch sometimes.
Yeah,
not really.
Nah, it's fine. Nah, so okay. So now I got some questions for you.
Okay.
So some like stuff I like to ask. I like obviously we talked a lot about like your low periods where you said that you. I mean, one of my questions is like, when are you gonna quit? You already answered that.
Yeah.
But what has been like the best moment of your career? The moment you're like, this is like all the 15-hour car rides it took, the 15-hour bus ride to Romania. All this stuff that just killed me, like what has been like, it's all worth it because I accomplished this. Like, what's the best moment of your career?
It's hard for me to say right now because, like, I feel like my best moments are yet to come.
Mm-hmm.
But I would say, like, winning in Sweden because I hadn't won in so long. I've been winning all my life.
Yeah.
Like,
Successful youth career.
From the age of 9 to the age of 18.
Yeah.
Like, all we did was, like, if you go into my house, like, my bedroom, I have, like, my medals like this, my trophies all over the place. Like, all I did was, like, win. And then, like, for a long period of time, like, I hadn't had that final success. Like, yeah, we'd win games, but I hadn't won a league. I hadn't won a, like, championship. So to win that and be a part, like, a key piece of it.
Yeah.
I think that was like a very, very, very big thing for me. But I don't know. I look back and I would say like the youth championships, it meant more. Cause even back then we worked extremely hard.
Yeah.
Like we worked a lot harder. Like now I think about it, we worked a lot harder than our opposition, and that's why we actually did win. Because I would say we had a lot of talented players, but we weren't the best team, like U14, U15, and we won. You know, like, so for me, like, those years when we weren't the best and we still won, it was like, I look back and, like, now, like, I'm like, yeah, I love that moment.
Yeah.
It's like my childhood friends. But professionally, I would have to say that moment in Sweden.
Uh-huh.
And then the end of this season with Tulsa, obviously when we host a trophy, That'll be,
dude, that would
be the next one. That'd be the next one.
I already did that in this season. And then if you could go back to yourself at like a young, usually I say 16, but like any time in your career that you think you need it, what piece of advice would you have for your younger self?
I would say, honestly, and it's not even necessarily advice, I would have honestly told myself after my freshman year of college to leave and go play pro.
After freshman year?
After freshman year.
You think you were ready? And
I think at that point, or even like going into my freshman year, the confidence that I had, because I went into college at 17. I went in early, at 17.
Wow.
I didn't turn 18 to the end of the season.
Wow.
So like, I was 18, and I had a lot of confidence. Maybe more confidence than I should have had.
Yeah.
Like, trying stuff that I should, like dribbling. Like, I was athletic, same size. And I just feel like at that point, if I went on the journey that I kind of went on now, then at 18. Because I felt like even like mentally and like I was strong enough to kind of handle that. And at 18, it's kind of like I could still go to the under 21s, under 23s. And like maybe a career path's a little different. Because at 18, I would say matched up to like a, not the best 18-year-olds in the world, but like just a regular 18-year-old at an academy club.
Yeah.
Very comparable.
Mm.
So if I could have got in and I had a British passport, I'm starting to think like,
yeah,
take that chance and go.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And if it doesn't work out, people will say, well, what if it doesn't work out? Well, if it doesn't work out, I'll be 22 and I'll go to college.
Yeah.
And I'll you know what I mean? Like, then I know, like, I've given myself that window of, like, the 4 years to really, really
push. Key, like, 18 to 22.
To be a top professional.
Yeah.
And if it doesn't work out, because I always say, like now, like, the kids that go, that are, like, professionals at 18, even in the States, like, the way they'll develop from 18 to 22 playing against men who's experienced it,
yeah,
they'll never get that in college.
Yeah.
You'll never get that.
That's true, yeah.
But at the same time, there's kids that need to go to college.
I was going to say, I think it depends.
So it depends on the person. Like,
because me at 18, I wasn't ready for it. Like,
really?
Technically, tactically, like, as a player, I wasn't, even at 22, like, I struggled my first year in the, like, training with pros.
Really?
I was just... Ask Nemanja about me at Sacramento, bro.
Oh, Vuko was there.
Yeah, Vuko was there. I wasn't ready. Like, I needed it. But, like, there are players
that can, yeah.
Like, if you're yourself at, like, 18 that were ready, you know, DJ, you know?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I look back and I'm like, I don't necessarily think, obviously I wasn't the sharpest, I wasn't the smartest, I wasn't the, but I felt like I would have been 18, like, oh, yeah, this 18-year-old. They would have looked at me like, oh, that 18-year-old's going to be special.
Yeah.
Not
that
18-year-old needs to get out of here. He's turned. Like, yeah. Messing our training up, you know?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So it would have been like that type of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that's one thing I would say.
Mm-hmm.
And then I would tell maybe like at like 16 to just focus a little bit more.
On what?
Just details, small details. Like position and stuff, like
because there's a lot as you learn, like 26 now, you're like how did I even play soccer at 18?
Yeah, like
I can't even think about like where I need to be,
like simple stuff, like just like spacing, like if I get wider to the line, if I get higher, if I get higher up and I pin the outside mid like back, my center back can take the ball up, or if he doesn't follow me, I'm open.
Yeah,
like just little stuff, like going up then popping down again, just like little things like that, the details and stuff, because like now I look at it, I'm like, I can see like how to create space for myself and for others.
Yeah.
Before, like you kind of knew like, okay, if I make this run,
you have like
he's going to go with me.
Mm-hmm.
But like, you know how to really, really create space, like different situations.
Because you have like a gut instinct, but you don't actually know.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
That's cool. All right. Well, that's all I got. Anything else you want to end off with? Anything you want to say?
No,
I got one more question.
Sorry.
I got one more question. Why did you make it to the pro level, or even to continue to play as far as you have? It's 26 now. Versus, why do you think you made it farther than a lot of other people that had maybe more talent, same amount of talent?
Everything? To be honest, a lot of it is, I would say for me personally, like I would say genetics, left foot, like my size, my athleticism, my left foot, like those are three things that are like innate that a lot of people don't have, and people always looking for a left-footed player.
Yeah,
I can play center back, I can play left back, like that type of thing. Like I had the ability to play professionally, but then outside of that, I would just say perseverance.
Yeah,
like just wanting it more than the next person.
Yeah, like how many people are gonna drive overnight 15 hours
exactly?
Yeah, to go to Charleston.
It's crazy, but if you really really want it, like you'll do what it takes. And like this time, like, and there will be times where, like, where I would go on some trials and like I wouldn't do well, and I'm like, I know why I didn't do well. I wasn't putting in the work prior to getting there. I was kind of like half-assed, like kind of doing it but not really doing it, and you see the results, like you don't make it.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's what I would say. Perseverance. Just perseverance. Yeah.
I like it. Sweet. Well, this is good. This is my longest podcast so far.
It's the best one. I told you it's the best one.
Dude, honestly, the story is pretty crazy.
So guys, AJ, DJ, who else is there?
Anthony.
Sorry, guys. The best podcast. The
best podcast so far. All right, guys. This is Moses. All his social media, like always, will be in the description.
Yeah, follow me on Instagram.
Yeah.
Twitter.
Don't worry. Y'all put the little, as soon as you come up on the screen, it'll go hashtag, pop.
Yeah. Yeah, guys, follow me, please.
Yeah, you get it.
I need those followers. No, just kidding. <Yeah. laughs>
But seriously. All right, guys. This is the Against All Odds podcast with Moses, Benga, McKinde.
Yeah.
Dude, honestly, Sip was calling you Benga all this time. Yeah. I'm like, who's Benga? I thought he was saying Benga. Like,
oh, no. See, that's not, so you can just say it just like that. Like
Benga.
Just
Benga.
It's close enough. Exactly.
Okay.
Exactly.
Moses, Benga, McKinde.
Yes.